Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop Podcast. All right, I'm going to warn you right up ahead of time. It is the beginning of February. It is freezing here in Michigan, and so my furnace is probably going to kick on at some point or another during the episode. But what I want to share with you today is I want to talk about block planes. Now, block planes, in my opinion at least, are an essential tool regardless of whether you're a power tool user or a hand tool user. They are key tools in your workshop, and because they can do so much for you. You know, even if you are just all power tool, I guarantee that you will actually find a use for the block plane to help just kind of chewing up little things here and there, maybe cleaning up a little bit of the saw marks that are left from your tools. And it really is an essential one. Now, I actually prefer a low-angle block plane, which is what both of these are. In fact, actually, this is my Stanley number 60 and a half, which was one of my first major power or hand tool purchases, believe it or not. And then later on, I upgraded to this Veritas version. And I'm going to share with you a couple of things to look for when you're actually going to pick up your block planes. The 60 and a half has worked really great. I still grab it once in a while, but I really actually prefer my Veritas one. And I'll explain why in a couple of minutes. But like I said, when it comes down to it, these are really essential tools regardless of how you feel about power or hand tool. And so I think it's really important to understand what are some key characteristics that are important to look at when you go to purchase it. So I think what we're going to do now is we're actually going to head over to the workbench. I'm going to kind of step out of the way so you can get a closer look at these. And we're going to kind of take them apart and look at what are important features. Okay, so the next thing that we're going to do is let's actually take a look at a few things that we definitely need to be really concerned with. Now, of course, here we have the actual beds themselves. And as you can see a little bit closer, the actual mechanism. This one is both, you know, forward and back with the blade and then the lateral adjustment. This one, pretty much two different components. But the one thing that I like about the Veritas one is the fact that because it has this one mechanism, I actually feel like I get it locked in a little bit more. It's very easy as I'm pushing forward with this to accidentally bump the actual mechanism here, which then kind of rocks the whole blade back and forth, and it can knock off the way that I have it set up. One more thing with the Veritas one, and some people really like this, some people don't like it. I don't mind it, is the way I'll put it, is there are these two set screws, and you can see them from the sides. And what these actually do is they help to make sure that your alignment, every single time you go to set the blade in there, you can get it set up and it kind of locks it in. And this is another feature that actually helps to make sure that the blade stays right where you want it. So if you did come back and accidentally bump this a little bit, you know for sure that it's still going to be in the same, pretty much the same area as a result of those. And not to mention the fact that every time you come back from sharpening the blade, it's a lot easier to get it all lined up. Now, let's talk about the blades themselves. Now, this is the Veritas one, and it's a pretty thick blade. This is the original Stanley one, and you can kind of see as I line the two of them up, the Stanley one is easily, now I'm not exaggerating too much here, not quite half, but almost half half the thickness of the other one. So this one is definitely going to eliminate a lot of chatter as we're actually using it. And chatter can give you horrible, you know, marks on the wood itself as you're using it. So those are a couple of things to think about. Now, one thing, when we actually have the blade itself, we'll move that out of the way. Like I said, we want to think about the mouth itself. We want it to be able to open and close rather easily. Now, of course, with the Veritas one, I kind of wish I had this little lever like I do on the Stanley number 60 and a half, but still, the mouth opens and closes, and I kind of feel along the edges, it stays right in the same plane, which is important because if any sawdust were to get trapped in here, it could actually raise it up, and that would also really throw off the cuts that you're actually going to make with it. So one thing when you're looking at the mouth is pay attention to that. Make sure that it sits the right way, that it does open and close rather easily. Because really when it comes down to it, if we close the mouth, we can use this for finer shavings, really, really delicate cuts to get really sneak up on the final fitting that you want, or just to remove small, small amounts. Because if you're working with a tricky grain, if you can remove small, small amounts, you won't get anywhere near as much tear out as if you had this wide open and we're hogging out a lot of material. And of course, there are times that we do want to hog out a lot of material. We just want to get down to the basic shape, and then we can come back and kind of close the mouth and actually, you know, get those fine shavings. So the mouth is very, very important to pay attention to. Now, another thing is I like a wider wing here. Now, of course, if I roll this over, you can kind of see that this wing, excuse me, is a lot bigger than this wing. And regardless of the holds or anything. What's going to happen is when I actually go to use this for a shooting board, this one has a lot more support than this one does, and it's a lot easier for me to get my fingers in there and grip it and really kind of push it forward. So this is something else that I like. Now, when we get these block planes home, we want to make sure that the body is set up the right way, because it can look good, it can have a nice wide wing, the mouth can open and close the right way, the blade can be nice and thick, the mechanisms work perfectly fine, but if this sole of this plane is not, you know, pretty darn flat, if it's not square to the wing itself, then you pretty much just bought yourself a nice piece of scrap metal. So I always like to kind of grab my trusty straight edge, and I'll check, and sure enough, as I look at it, I'll check it in three spots, one on the edge, one on the edge, one in the middle. Sure enough, it looks nice and flat. And then I'll do the same. I'll come to the, I know you can't really see this much, but I'm just kind of doing this. It's like, oh, just give me an idea. Oh yeah, it's nice and flat. And if it's not, if there's just a little bit of variation, well, refer to the labbing video that we did, and you can do the same thing with your block plane, and you'll get, you know, just as decent results, just as good of results. In fact, you'll actually get them a lot faster. So let's take a look next at what I want to pull up is the actual cap irons themselves. These are very, very important, because really when it comes down to it, these are what are holding the blade to the body, and if they're not strong enough, every single cut you make, even if it's a very thin cut, a very, very thin shaving, if these aren't very strong and they're not holding the blade in place, then your shavings are going to be, you're going to get a lot of chatter, you're going to have some really bad, you know, tear out and everything else. So once again, we'll kind of look at it, and here's the Stanley one, obviously, here's the Veritas one, and when you look at them, again, it's like Laurel and Hardy, basically. I mean, the Veritas one is nice and thick. We'll turn it on its side. So which one is going to hold down a lot tighter? Yeah, this one right here, the Veritas one. I mean, look at the size of that. Even when you compare the actual widths, I mean, sure, the Veritas blade obviously is going to be a little bit wider. Let's pull the blades back up here again. You can kind of see that the Veritas one is wider, but really when it comes down to it, let's put this Stanley cap iron on here. Look at that. It pretty much covers the majority of the edge, but you'll see when I actually put the whole mechanism back together in the plane, the cap iron actually kind of sits way behind here. We want it more up towards here. We don't want it right on the bevel, but we want it closer, because that will make sure that the blade is being held tight against the bed. And if it's being held tight against the bed, then we're going to get better results. Now we'll actually pull the Veritas one. We'll grab this. And as you can see, it does actually pretty much, yeah, it actually overlaps it just a little bit from edge to edge, so that you get a better result from it. It's going to minimize the chatter that you're going to be dealing with. And I know for a fact that the Lee Nielsen version, they have a nice thick cap iron on it too, which really helps to hold it down. Very, very important when you go to purchase a block plane, make sure you get one that all of this is crucial. This is very important. You got to look for these things. Don't just buy the first one that comes along. I have gotten great results with my number 16.5. I still use it, but I don't use it for as delicate work or important fittings as I do with my actual Veritas one. So I'm going to go ahead and put everything back together. And then, like I said, we'll just kind of go over some of the finer characteristics of it, point the things back out again, and then we'll kind of go from there. I've got a couple accessories that I want to show you for the Veritas one that I think are really neat. I've talked about them in the episodes. Okay, so we've got the blades back in place, and now what we are actually going to do is put the cap irons on. So we are the lever caps. So we put the Stanley number 16.5 on first. We kind of get it in place, and I want you to note, let me see if I can kind of zoom in here just a little bit. Sorry about that. Okay, so we get the cap iron on here, and of course it's going to have a little play, but that's no big deal. And then we'll lock that into place. And notice that distance between the top of the bevel and then where the cap iron itself starts. Okay, so now we're going to take the Veritas one. And this is one thing to note, is a lot of times we make the mistake of tightening these down so much that we have to actually loosen them up in order to get the lever cap back on. And you don't need to do that. Really, this is just kind of to more or less provide a anchoring mechanism for the cap iron itself. You want all the pressure on the cap iron to be on there, not this. This shouldn't actually be holding the cap iron. This is what, as you're tightening the cap iron, pushes against it and then thus holds it down. So anyways, though, let's take a look at this. Now, as I showed you when they were apart, look at the whole width of the cap iron on this. I mean, I'll pull it up just a little bit more. It pretty much takes up the whole entire balance in here. There's very little space on either side. And then note the distance between where the cap iron actually engages the blade and then the distance to the blade. Let me grab the 16.5. This one does have, you can kind of see, it's a little bit metal showing on the sides. And then again, the distance, there's more here. So that, what this means is this cap iron is actually holding the blade down where you want it the most. This guarantees, well, at least it does a lot better job of making sure that when you actually go to use it, that you're not gonna get this blade actually lifting up and chattering. I mean, it will to some degree cause a little bit of a chatter, and you'll see this on the wood itself. So this is in place now. And with this lever cap actually in place, I can still actually, notice how I can side to side a little bit there. I probably should zoom back out. But with this one, remember the side to side, the lateral adjustment is here. And as long as this is tightened, I can't get this to move back and forth. I can get it to go, in and out, but I can't get it to go side to side. So that's very important because a lot of times, let me kind of zoom back out here. When we're actually using this, we are going to have our hand back here. It's going to be like this. We're going to be pushing down this way, however it's going to be. And it's very easy to move this one while you're doing that because you can kind of accidentally grab it the wrong way and, oh, there it goes, that kind of a thing. So you can see why it's very important to look, number one, to make sure which hand plane is going to work best for you, which block plane. Like I said, I like a low angle one. I prefer the Veritas one, and of course the Lee Nielsen also. It's nice and thick, just like this one. The main thing is this cap iron right here to make sure that it holds down nice and tight near the blade, have the adjustable mouth. Check out the lateral adjustment. It should be easy to use, but not so easy that while you're actually using it, you can accidentally move it. This one happens to me all the time with this when I'm actually using it. So those are a couple of things to think about. Now, one thing I want to do is let's actually show the block plane in actual use. Okay, so we're actually over at the workbench itself, and what we're going to do is I just took this piece off of my miter saw and a nice little miter to it, and I want to take the low angle block plane and I actually want to clean up the saw marks that are on here. Just give it a nice little bit of a finish. It's ready to go right now, but I just like to take the opportunity to get a nice tighter fit with it. Sometimes with the ripples, the glue will work perfectly fine. You probably won't even notice it. I mean, you really have to be pretty finicky to actually be concerned about it. But I just like the fact that the surface between the two mating pieces is dead flat as possible with just a little bit of glue in there, and I get great results. So we're getting ready to do this part. Now, one thing I want to show you is on my low angle block plane, I like to have the blade just projecting just enough. We don't want to take a lot of material because it's going to make it difficult when we actually go to do it with the plane. And on top of it, I want the mouth as tight as possible. Here, I'll kind of show you on this side, see if I can get it just the right way. You can see there's not really much of a mouth there. The line is very, very tight. I'll move it a little bit that way, a little bit that way. And you can kind of see it on the inside maybe. But anyway, so what will happen is by having the mouth closed as tight as possible, but being able to allow the chips to roll through, the shavings will actually break off earlier and we'll get a better result. So anyways though, let's go ahead and kind of get started. Put all the pressure here at the thumb, kind of support it. I'm pushing down and then I'm gonna push in. And preferably what's gonna happen is that we'll actually get a shaving off the end grain rather than just sawdust. If we're getting sawdust, sometimes it happens when we're first getting started, but preferably we're gonna have shavings. And it's a lot easier actually to get shavings off of a mitered cut like this. And there you go. So I'll show you, we'll move to the end grain in just a second and do a square one where basically we have the same thing. I more or less made a cut with this one, and you know what, we'll put a little bit of orange on this just to help highlight it. Slide it down just a little bit so we get more support on the actual bench itself. Again, using the tighter mouth, actually for the beginning, since this one is really rough, I'm going to open the mouth just a pinch to help kind of get it down early or a little bit faster. Again, supporting. Of course, normally I would have something on the end to avoid the tear out. See, we are kind of getting we're getting the shavings. All right, so now we've got that flattened just a little bit. Blow the chips out of the way. We'll come back, we'll close the mouth again just a little bit more so that it's nice and tight, and we'll finish this up. There you go. Of course, like I said, normally I would have a support piece on the back, but there you go. We're getting shavings rather than sawdust itself. And that's all we really have to do to clean this up. And as you can see, the best part about it is this cap iron right here. This will help to hold the blade down tight so that it doesn't give us a lot of chattering. If I were to actually do it with my Stanley number 16 and a half here, they're not really set up here, but it really would actually kind of not result in the best situation. In fact, actually, yeah, I'm not even gonna try because it's not working the way it's supposed to. But anyways though, you kind of get the idea. Okay, well I hope that helps out. You know, when it comes down to buying a low angle block plane or just a block plane, there are those important characteristics to pay attention to. You know, like the mouth, make sure that open and closes relatively easy and that it stays flat and it stays in place. Of course, there are block planes that the mouth doesn't open and close on. So if you want one that does, pay attention to that to make sure that you're purchasing a model that actually has it so that it moves back and forth. Pay attention to the actual sole of the plane itself. When you get it, double check it, especially if you buy it from a manufacturer like Veritas or Lee Nielsen. If it's way out of whack, you really shouldn't have to spend much time getting it in place. If it's really out of position, send it back immediately because they're gonna be very concerned about that for you because it's, you know, you're paying a premium for them and they wanna make sure you're getting the best results from it. Now also, when it comes to the sole, we want to make sure the wings, because a lot of block planes are actually used for shooting boards, so make sure that it's nice and square to the sole before you actually do that. Another characteristic that I said was important is the movement of the blade, the projection, and then also the lateral. It should be easy, but not so easy that while you're using it, it's going to be knocked out of place. That's very, very important because obviously when we're working on something very crucial, when we're trying to get a nice fine tune to it, we don't want it to be messed up. One more thing is the actual cap iron itself, or the lever cap, excuse me. We want to make sure that it supports the blade, that it holds it tight to the body, and that it pretty much spans the width of the blade itself. And this is true for pretty much every single plane that's out there. This cap iron here is very important to make sure that the blade stays in place. Otherwise, it can allow it to chatter a little bit and you'll feel the chatter. It's like going down a bumpy road. So it's very crucial that you pay attention to that. Now, one thing I also like about the Veritas Veritas low-angle block plane, and also this is true for their standard block plane, is that you can actually buy a kit that can convert this into basically a low-angle smoother is what it comes down to, like a number two, number three size. So I mentioned this before that I've actually used mine for that situation. You can set the blade up so that it has a nice rounded edge on it so that you can get a nice result from it. And really, you just have to buy a kit from Veritas that consists of either, I should mention they've got a tail ball like this one, or you can get an actual tote. This is just new on the market. And then, of course, there is a knob that goes on the front to give it that larger knob. And actually, in some of my videos, I think I might have demonstrated this, I actually prefer that large knob to use it all the time when I have it, because I feel like I can get more control over the toe, especially like when you saw today's video when I was, look at that, I mean, it gives it a little bit bigger. And just imagine that, like you're gonna use this on a shooting board, you've got just that much more to hold on to, or like we're demonstrating today, it's a little bit easier to hold on to it when I'm shooting the end grains. And then, just to kind of show you what it looks like, there's two screws back here at the end that this kind of sits in here, and there are already two holes on the bottom that it pops into, and then you tighten the screws down, and then now, voila, you have yourself a little smoother, and you know what, it works great. This is a great little setup. I forget how much this is extra. I think it's only like about $25 at the most, and then you get the knob and the tote itself, or you have the ball tail, and it works really, really great as a miniature little smoother. So anyways though, that's pretty much it. I think I'm actually going to be doing another video coming up pretty soon where we are going to be demonstrating some of the other things that you can actually use the block plane for. Cutting chamfers, actually rounding over an edge, just like you would use a round over router bit. So we're going to do that video next. And until then, you know, if you've got any questions, comments, feedback, whatever, drop me a line at matsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. That's also where you can enter for all the free swag drawings. And you can easily stop over the website at matsbasementworkshop.com and just leave us feedback over there, or click on some of the links and either visit some of the other podcasters or make some purchases, whatever. So anyway, so I think that's pretty much going to do it. Thanks for stopping by. And like I said, in our next video, we're going to demonstrate actually using the block plane to, like I said, do some chamfers and a few other things. So until then, straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.